At least the inspiration for much of reinforcement learning, right? So here is one slide takeaway. People are going to doze after this. I know it's hard to stay awake at 2 o'clock in a nice air-conditioned room. So even if you're going to doze away after this, one slide takeaway for you to remember. So one of the main contributions that came out of the reinforcement learning community was this notion called the temporal difference learning, right? So where it's a very simple rule that explains complex behaviors. So the prediction of an outcome, like food or whatever, right? Or of a punishment or some juice or whatever is coming to you, right? The prediction of the outcome that you can make at time t plus 1 is necessarily going to be better informed than the prediction of the outcome you can make at time t. So what I could do is I can look at what the prediction I'm making at t plus 1 and try to adjust my prediction at time t to move towards the predictions that I make at a later time. I don't have to wait till I see the final outcome. Right? So I could actually start learning in an online fashion. So this is known as the temporal difference learning. So I take the prediction I make at time t plus 1, look at the prediction at time t, form the error, and use that for updating my prediction. So this is called the temporal difference learning. And this has had a profound impact in behavioral psychology, and to some extent, I'm not sure that Partha would agree with me, but to some extent in at least some sub-disciplines of computational neuroscience. Yeah, looking at it in terms of behavioral modeling, right? So that is something which they brought to the table. Yeah. Right? So RL has been used in a variety of places, right? So when it's been used for training robots, so that's a snapshot from Robo Soccer team from UT Austin. Actually, there's one UT Austin person. There you go. So that's the Austin Villa team, the humanoid team playing soccer, and they actually trained it using a mix of supervised learning and reinforcement learning. And that's actually a helicopter flying upside down. I mean, it's not. I didn't make an editing mistake and put the picture upside down, right? So they actually, people at Stanford, and Berkeley have trained helicopters to fly in all kinds of trick maneuvers on helicopters using reinforcement learning, right? And in fact, one of the toughest one is to actually get the helicopter to fly upside down, because mechanically the system is not geared to do that. So it becomes a much harder control problem, right? And it's also had significant success in playing games, right? That's one of the hallmarks of success in AI, right? So if you get a successful gameplay agent, right? So reinforcement learning, in fact, had arguably the best backgammon player. So people who don't know what backgammon is, it's like Ludo, right? So for the Indian audience, if we say it's Ludo, everybody understands what it is. Like you roll dice, you move pieces around, right? And then you get pieces off the board, and that's essentially what you're looking to do. Except that there are only two sides instead of four. Right. And it's actually a pretty complex game, and there are even world championships of backgammon. And in the late 90s, so IBM, the Jerry Tassaro from IBM, had a backgammon agent which could beat the best human player at that point. Right. And likewise, this is a snapshot from a game of Go. This person, David Silver, from University of Alberta, who actually built an agent for playing Go, RL Go. And Go is considered one of the toughest board game for AI agents to play, because the branching factor is very, very large. You know, typically in computer science, when you're building this artificial game playing agent, they try to build a tree of how the game would progress, right? And this tree is going to have like 400 plus branches at every stage, right? So you can imagine how quickly the tree is going to become unmanageable, right? So David came up with this agent that uses reinforcement learning and some form of search in order to build a very successful RL agent. And here's another example where people have actually used it, deployed it in practice, where this is a snapshot from a Yahoo News screen, where the news items that show up on the page, right? So there are like 20 or so news items that the editors would pick up as being of interest, current interest, and which items do I display on the page was actually determined through a reinforcement learning algorithm. Right?
So in the previous slide, the prediction of t plus one temporal instant is better than predicting the temporal instant t. So how can it be possible? Because the prediction of t connects an error, and at t plus one we have to propagate.
So the thing is, the way to think about it is t plus one is closer to the end. So you have fewer, lesser noise that you have to worry about when you're looking at some kind of an averaging over all the past history that you have seen, right? So that's one intuition for telling you why t plus 1 would be better than t. So this is, I'll get back to this in a little bit more detail later, right? So but then, this is just to give you a feel that reinforcement learning has been used all over the place, right? In automatic control, gameplay, customization, recommendation, and so on and so forth, right? So one of the key questions that distinguishes reinforcement learning from other forms of learning is this explore-exploit dilemma, right? Because I do not really know anything about the system, right? So let's say that I'm trying to write a cycle. Right, I figure out some way to stay balanced, you know. Say maybe I hang off the off my seat slightly to an angle to the left, and somehow I make sure that I don't fall off. You know, I don't know if people have seen kids who are too short to ride cycles, right? And when they try to ride a cycle, you must, you know, if you've seen them, they don't actually sit on the seat. Right? They actually hang on the side, and then they manage to do right. So they have found a way to ride a cycle. Do they just stick with it, or do they try to improve it? I mean, they're not going to fall off. They're not going to get hurt. But it's not the ideal way of riding a cycle, right? So there could be better ways of doing it, right? So this is the explore-exploit dilemma. So I found some satisfactory solution. Do I stick with it, right? Or do I try to improve on it, to try to see if there is a better solution? So at which point, right, do I say that, okay, I have done enough, right? I know what I really can know about the system, and this is the best I could do, and I just stick with it, right? So this is the exploitation part of it. And the exploration part of it is, no, I really need to understand the system better, so let me explore the system a little bit more. Right? This becomes a hard problem in the absence of any knowledge about the system. Right? So think about helicopter flying. Right? We could think about writing down the actual dynamical systems that control the helicopter and then try to build a controller using traditional electrical engineering ideas. But then it turns out that the system is very, very complex. That even if I have knowledge about the individual components that go into the system, it's very hard for me to write an end-to-end model for the system, right? So in such cases, I really cannot look at traditional ways of solving the problem, and I have to go into this kind of an explore-exploit mode. I have to say, okay, if I push the helicopter a little bit this way, okay, what's going to happen? Right? Is it going to tilt too much? Then I probably should not be going that direction, right? Of course, you need to have, the helicopter is a little bit of a bad example, because people needed to put in actual fail safes in there to make sure you're not crashing the helicopter. Otherwise, I might explore too much and then end up needing to buy a lot of helicopters. Right? So, so you get the drift, right? So I need to be able to explore in order to discover more about the system. Right? So we're going to talk about what are called the bandit problems initially, which essentially encapsulate this explore-exploit problem. They primarily concern themselves with this explore-exploit problem, right? So here is the simplified version of it. So I have multiple choices that I can make at a given point. Let's call them actions. So I have n actions. I'll be using actions and arms interchangeably for the first part. So I have n actions, right? I could pick any one of those n actions at a given time instant. Right? When I pick an action, I'm going to get some kind of a payoff. It could be somebody standing there and saying, hey, good job, right? Or some pin picking you. Or to make it all tractable and mathematical, I'll say I'm going to get some number, right? So I'll either get a plus one, okay, or I'll get a zero or a minus one, right? I'll get a plus one or a zero when I pull the arm, right? So this rewards or this payoffs that I'm getting when I pull an arm or take an action is determined by some unknown probability distribution. So if I'm talking about plus one and zero, it could be some kind of a Bernoulli distribution. Right? This is some unknown distribution. I have no idea what this distribution is. Right? I draw a sample from this distribution. Suppose I have n arms, I'm going to have n such distributions. So what I'm really doing is, when I pick an action, I'm choosing one of those distributions, and I'm asking you to give me a sample from that distribution. Right? So you could think of, I'll make it a little bit more concrete. So let's look at this case. Right? So I have, like, say, 20 different news stories which the editors have picked up for me. Right? So what do? These stories are my arms. So when I pull an arm, that means that I'm going to put a story here. Right? I'm going to display the story. When I pull an arm, that means I'm going to take that particular story corresponding to the arm and put it there. Right? And the payoff I'm going to get is a plus one if the user clicks on the story. If he clicks on the story and reads it, that means I made a valid choice. It's of interest to the user. right? And therefore he's clicking on it. So that'll get me a reward of plus one. If the user does not click on it, I get a reward of zero. So this is essentially how to think about the system. So if somebody clicking on it gives me a reward of plus one, right? And so that's essentially it. So the distribution from which this plus ones and zeros are being drawn is completely unknown to me, and in some sense unknowable, right? I'm talking about trying to figure out what is the news reading preference of an anonymous user who has just shown up on my web page, right? So this is not something that I can easily estimate. So this has to, I can't build a model of the user, right? So, well, I'll talk about building a model of the user later, right? But in general, it's not an easy task to do, right? So we have to come up with other ways of doing it. So that's essentially the crux of the bandit problems, right? So the goal here is to figure out, okay, given a user, so what is the story that is most likely to receive a click on it? Right? So there is some kind of a probability associated with each of these outcomes, and I want to pick that arm or that action which gives me the maximum payoff or maximum expected payoff over all these arms. So the explore-exploit dilemma comes in here, right? I don't know what the expected payoff is. And if I know what is the expectation for each of those arms, I can just go and pick the arm that has the maximum expectation. And if I knew those a priori, right? So I really don't have any learning problem. I just look at all the mu's here. I'll pick the mu that has the highest value and then report that as my answer. But I can't do that because I don't know what the mu's are to begin with, so I have to explore. In fact, if I have 20 different stories, I have to show those 20 stories at least once. Right? In fact, I might have to show them some m number of times each before I have some sense of what the expectation is. So that is a minimum number of times that I have to explore before I can start exploiting. Basically, exploitation in this case would be to say that, okay, I'll take the story which has the highest estimated click-through rate, the highest estimated payoff, and I'll keep showing that story again and again. So for me to be able to say that is the exploitation part. For me to be able to say that, it'll take a little bit of exploration. Right? So this is where the exploration-exploitation trade-off comes in. So when do I know that I have estimated the expectations accurately so that I can stop and start exploiting? So that's the explore-exploit question. Right? And so this is one example of that. So here is another example where people actually use reinforcement learning or variants of the bandit algorithms, which is an ad selection. Right, and also in things like content recommendation. So here in this case, these are all comments in a particular blog, and people actually use adaptive system for recommending, like pushing up different comments to the top, and the kind of reward that they are using is essentially the thumbs up and thumbs down signal that people are giving. So these are kind of very natural settings where you can use the bandit algorithm, right? So here is the slide again, just to recap this quickly.
Story has to be displayed.
That's exactly what solving the problem is all about.
Nice.
Yeah. So I'll talk about a little bit of it. Right. I'm not going to get into the details of it. Like I said, A, the audience is fairly varied, and B, it's the afternoon slot. So I didn't want to get into the mathematical details of it. I'll give you some intuition as to how things are done. Okay. So there are many different objectives here. Right. So one of the things I've been talking about so far is to identify the current arm eventually. So I want to know which is the right story, but I want to get to it eventually. But that eventually is not always the right thing to do. For example, I'm talking about news stories. The news story is going to lose currency maybe in 8 hours, right? So here's a hot news story for you. How many of you know that there is a bomb threat in a Chennai school right now? So many, many schools are actually sending children back home now, right now. You knew about that, yeah. So it's I don't know how long it's going to be current, but so that's the hard story, right? So we need to be able to respond to these things quickly. So it's not that I'm not interested in knowing answers, right answer eventually, right? But I really like to be able to kind of maximize the total clicks I'm going to get on this, right? I'm not interested in waiting till end of time and figuring out what the right answer is, right? So here is a pictorial description of what I mean. Let us say I know what is the best story, right? And I have been showing it to you from the beginning. Right, so this is time and that's the payoff. So I'm going to expect some amount of payoff that's going to come, right? Because I know what is the best story and that's the optimum payoff I'm going to get. Right? But the fact that I'm learning, okay, causes me, my performance to improve gradually over time. Right? The fact that I'm learning causes my performance to improve gradually over time. So eventually I'm going to identify the optimal payoff, right? But this region here that you see, right, which is the loss in performance that I'm incurring in the initial stages of the learning, as I'm progressing towards my the best solution, is known as a regret. You know, if one way of thinking about it, alas, if I had known the answer in the beginning, okay, I could have done much better. Right? So that regret is what I'm trying to minimize. This allows me to respond very quickly to things that are changing. Right? So this is one of the performance measures that people use more and more, especially in this kind of industrial deployment. Right? So another performance measure, which is of interest to the theory folks, is called the PAC framework, or the probably approximately correct framework, where I'm not interested in giving you the right answer, right? But I'm okay as long as I'm somewhere close to that, as long as I'm epsilon optimal. Suppose my best arm will get, say, 1,000 clicks a day. If I can give you something that will get 990 clicks a day, I'm happy. Right? But I want you to do this with a very, very high probability. Right? So regardless of the mix of customers that are going to come to my web page, right, regardless of the mix of users that I'm going to see, regardless of the type of news stories I'm going to see, right, across all of this, I don't care what conditions that are there in the problem, with some probability, like with 95% probability, I'll assure you that the story that I'll give you will get 990 clicks a day. Right? Do you get that? So there is a probably part here, which is with 95% probability, I'll give you the right answer. And then the approximate part here, where the right answer is slightly off from the best answer. So that's basically called the probably approximately correct framework. This is one of the more popular frameworks in theoretical machine learning, which people use for analyzing different algorithms. And so in this case, the goal is to minimize the number of times that I have to pull arms before I can give you this guarantee. So there is a guarantee that I need to give you. How many times do you have to pull these arms before I can give you this guarantee? So that's the kind of the PAC framework that we are talking about. And so there are different kinds of algorithms. So I'm going to start, I'll give you a couple of simple algorithms, right? So I'm not going to get into the more, slightly more involved ones. I'm going to talk about a few simple algorithms. And so the first one is essentially the dumbest thing that you can think of doing, right? So what is that? I don't know what the expectations are. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to pull a lot of arms. Right? I'm just going to pull the arms. Right, and then form an expectation out of it. Just look at the empirical, the rewards that I'm going to get. Right, I pull the arms multiple times, I look at the payoffs I'm getting. So each the way to translate it to our news story analogy, each news story I'll show, say, 10 times, I'll see how many clicks I get. Right, and I'll take the average. Right, and I'll use this as my estimate of the true expectation. Right, and then I'm going to take the best out of this and show it to the user. So I'll use this as my arm. Right? This is like a greedy strategy. Right? But the greedy strategy has a problem. What is the problem? Right? If I show it too few number of times, then I'm going to be incorrect. Right? And I can't give you any kinds of guarantees, right? Unless the few times I show you is really, really large. Right? So instead of that, what we do is, so we have some kind of an epsilon greedy strategy. Right? So I will not be greedy all the time. I will not show you the best possible expected thing. I'll at random, with some small probability epsilon, right, I'll show you a any other picture, right, any other news story. I'll not show you the best one always. I'll show you any other news story, and then I'll see how many clicks you're going to make on it. So if you think about it very naively, right, as t tends to infinity, right, so even however small my epsilon is, I will show every arm infinitely often, right? I'll pull every arm infinitely often. Right? However small my epsilon is, as t tends to infinity, I'll pull every arm infinitely often. So I will get the true expectation. Right? So this epsilon greedy kind of an algorithm gives me that asymptotic guarantee. Right? So here is the, suppose you try to do a learning system with it, this is how the curves are going to look like. So as t becomes large enough, right, your learning performance is going to start converging and look optimal. Right? But then you really have no other guarantees other than the asymptotic convergence, right? So one caveat I want to mention here. So if you look at this, right? So when this for a particular choice of epsilon, that looks almost like it's converged, right? With a very, very few number of iterations. So it turns out that in reality, in many, many problems, epsilon greedy is actually hard to beat, right, in practice. So even though we can't give you any guarantees, any theoretical guarantees for this, right, it turns out to be hard to beat in practice. But then people come up with all kinds of more complex algorithms which are theoretically sound and also do well in practice. Right? So just a aside. If anyone is trying to use Bandit algorithms to solve a problem or anything, you could start off with this very simple epsilon greedy thing. You'll probably get a workable solution. Right, and there are many other approaches which have been there in the literature. So one of the earliest is called learning automata, or sometimes called variable structured stochastic automata, and they go back to the 1930s. There's this Russian mathematician Settler who actually proposed these variable structured stochastic automata for solving these variants of these bandit problems. Right, and then there's been a huge body of literature which has now goes by the name of learning automata. And there's a very good book by Narendra and Tatachar, which kind of reviews the whole field and gives you a flavor of the topics. And there is a very popular algorithm called the mean-in elimination algorithm, which actually introduced a round-based arm elimination technique into the community. So what essentially, suppose I had 10,000 arms, I don't try to pull all the 10,000 arms at every point of time. So I take some time off. Right? I pull all the 10,000 arms and then eliminate half of them. Then in the next time step, I'll pull half of the remaining half and keep eliminating until I'm left with only one arm. Right? So this turned out to be a very powerful technique and also amenable to theoretical analysis. So a lot of people started using this kind of round-based techniques for developing other solution methods. And the median elimination algorithm is still the kind of the champion in terms of the packed guarantees that people give. Right? And then there's this upper confidence bound methods, which again came up with one particular way of solving this problem, which is also then adapted the round-based approach by from the median elimination algorithm and became more powerful, which is, gives you very good regret guarantees. Right? And finally, there's a different way of sampling called Thompson sampling. So I'll not get into it, but it's for people who understand Bayesian approaches, this is some kind of a posterior. So you take the posterior estimate of the arm probabilities you have, and then you try to sample from that. Right? So that's essentially what Thompson sampling is. I'm not going to get into details of this, but I'm going to talk about UCB because it's a fairly simple and fairly intuitive algorithm. Right? In the epsilon greedy case, if you remember, so we used to maintain the expectations. Let's say these were the expectations of the arms that I had. Right? So this, let's say this axis is the reward, the payoff, and that is essentially some kind of index for the arm. So arm 1 has an expected payoff that is given here, arm 2 has an expected payoff here, arm 3 has an expected payoff here. So what I'm going to do is, I'm not only maintaining the expectations, but I'm also maintaining some kind of a confidence bound. How confident am I that the expected payoff for pulling arm 1 is this? How confident am I in the expected payoff pulling arm 2 is this? So basically, I'm maintaining this kind of a confidence interval, right? And whenever I need to pick an arm, so what I do is essentially pick the arm that has got the highest confidence interval. This is called the highest upper confidence bound. That's why it's called UCB algorithms. Right? So I look at the upper limit of the confidence bound, and I pick those arms, or those that arm that has the highest upper confidence bound. So I'm maintaining this, I'm getting the statistics, right? So I use the statistics. Originally, I was using it just to estimate the expectation. Now I can use it for the higher order start moments. Yeah. Can I turn on the mic?
So you use some sort of 90% confidence bound, or what?
Yeah. So it's essentially comes from the. So if you've been doing it empirically, you can use 95% confidence bond, right? Yeah, so we are, actually there are different ways in which you can do the upper confidence bound, right? So one of them is, I mean, suppose you're using some kind of a bootstrap kind of an estimate, you could use a 95% upper confidence bound, right? And otherwise you could use concentration bounds, right? And you want to have certain kind of guarantees on the error probabilities, right? And for, so you can choose appropriate concentration bound based on that guarantee you want on the error probabilities, right? Yeah, so it's pretty simple approach, right? And it turns out to be very powerful in practice. Right? And it turns out the amount of bookkeeping that you have to do to get this working is incredibly simple, right? So you have your expectations that you are maintaining as usual, right? So apart from that, all you need to keep track is the number of times you have played the arm so far. Anyway, having to use a lot of examples in this case, right? So we're talking about order of thousands of examples. Yeah, I want to reduce the regret region. So we can actually show with a little bit of analysis, we can show that this actually achieves a lower bound on the regret. Modulo some constants. This looks like a very simple algorithm, but actually achieves a lower bound on the regret. So the regret has to grow as log t. So t is the time steps. Right, the regret has to grow at least as log t, right? And this achieves log t regret. So that's a result from the 80s. So that the regret has to go, the lower bound on the regret growth is log t. So that's a result from the 80s, right? And so here the bound that you can give is that, so it's like bounded by some constant times ln n, right? Where n is the number of arms that you have, yeah.
So the assumption is that in the process of optimization, the distribution sort of stays.
Or constant, yeah. So stationary. So we're assuming
that
the distribution
is reasonable.
Well, it depends on your problem domain that you are looking at. So one of the things, let's go back to the news story thing, right? So let's say within a period of, let's say, 8 hours or something. Right? So I'm more or less assuming that the distribution of the interest in news is going to be constant, right? And this will probably be true if I take it across the entire population of people who are coming to my news website, right? So if I'm going to look at an individual, then there might be a larger fluctuation. But I'm going to look at the population of people who are coming to the site, so that would be correct. Well, that's always there, right? So news story comes in, my whole problem changes because I'll be changing the number of arms. Right, so I'll be using a different set of arms and so on and so forth. So these are things. So you have to take it with a little bit of a caveat. I mean, so you have to be careful that you are setting up a problem which is not too non-stationary. Right?
So in the new setting, so you would have to do this sort of optimization once every 8 hours. That's sort of the idea.
Yeah, or whatever frequency. 8 hours is just a number I picked out of the hat. Yeah, I mean, so whatever frequency you want, you can do.
So just to maybe clarify for people who have more of a statistics background,
okay.
Normally one is given a set of samples and one is estimating means and variances.
Yeah.
And here you are being allowed to choose.
Exactly.
That
brings the explorer exploit.
Right.
Yeah.
So that maybe that would help explain to people. Maybe there are like 5 biased coins and you're trying to estimate
the bias
probabilities
of, the coins,
of each
yeah.
of bias of each of the coins. But which of the coins should you pick to flip
sure.
next to get the most information about the bias?
Yeah,
one way to think about it.
That's
yeah.
perfect way of thinking about it. That would make the coin flipping problem a bandit problem. Yeah. So there are many variants on this. I'll talk about those a little later. So here is one thing which I wanted to get to. This is kind of pushing the boundary a little bit more than whatever we have been talking about so far. But if people have questions on this, feel free to ask now before I push on. Oh, good point. Let me go back. I had that picture on the slide. I forgot to tell you about this. Yeah, there you go. So these are slot machines. Right? Slot machines are also known as one-arm bandits because you pull the arm and they steal the money from you. Right? So that's essentially how these slot machines operate. And so these are multiple slot machines or one slot machine with multiple arms. You can choose which arm to pull. So they're called N-arm bandits. Right, so any other questions so far? Right. Okay, so I want to talk about what are called contextual bandits, right? So if you think about the ad scenario again, let me keep using the same example, right? This is not like I'm customizing the ads for one user. There are going to be multiple users that are going to keep coming to my web page, right? So how do I make sure that I'm serving the right ad for the right persons, right? So one way to do it would be to train one bandit for each user, right? So whenever, say, Partha logs into my browser on my web page, I should fire up the Partha bandit, you know? So that's the one that's optimized to steal money from Partha, right? But so that's That's not going to be feasible, right? So how many such people can I maintain these bandits for? That's one thing. And the second thing is, I would really need a lot of experience with the same user, right? So how often is the same user going to come to my web page in 8-hour window, right? So what I'm really am looking for is to actually have some kind of an abstract model of what of the user, right? And maybe use some kind of features, like the demographic features, right? Or the browsing history of the user, or the location from which the user is browsing, right? Or the kind of devices the user is using to browse the page. So I could form this kind of a profile based on different kinds of features about the user, right? And now what I'm going to do is maintain some kind of a parameterized representation for the expectation. So instead of saying that if I pull this arm, this is the expected payoff, right? I'm going to say if I pull this arm when this user is on my web page, right? This is the expected payoff, right? And this payoff is going to be given as a parameterized function. So I'm going to have some function, right, that will take as input, let's say the age of the user, right? Where the user is browsing from, right? And what is the previous web page that the user went to? So all of this will be given as input to this function, and this function will spit out a value that will tell me what is the expected payoff for pulling this arm for this user, right? So this is the kind of representation that I'm going to maintain, right? And right, so one way of doing it is to say that for each feature combination, again, I have a different bandit. So this is slightly better than saying for each user, I have a different bandit, right? But another way to say is that I'm going to have some kind of a function that, as Misha was talking about in the morning, you could have a linear function that takes these features, right, and then does some kind of a linear regression fit on it and gives you out a value. I say, okay, this is the expected payoff you're going to get for this kind of an input, right? And then based on that, you could have a UCB style algorithm, right? And it's called LIL-UCB. And in fact, it's one of the, again, one of the more popular UCB variants that people use all over the place, right? And yeah, I skipped a little bit of details on that. But then, of course, there's too many bars on this graph. Just that you should know that with very little experience, right? So the LIL-UCB actually, the LIL-UCB variants do better, right? But then if I have a lot of experience, basically I've looked at the entire user base, right? All the other methods also catch up, right? So when I've looked at as little as 10% of the user base, you could see that the UCB variants are the ones that are doing best. Right? So that essentially allows you to generalize across a lot of users, even with very little experience. So that's the idea behind using this kind of parameterized representations. And so the current status on bandits, like there are more powerful approximation techniques. I mean, there are, instead of using linear, I mean, people use Gaussian process regression for representing the value functions, right? And they're looking at all kinds of powerful sampling methods. So Thompson sampling is the current champion as far as regret analysis is concerned. And they also look at complex dependencies among the arms. So all through, I have been assuming that the payoffs associated with each of those arms is independent. But if you think back to the news story or the ad selection case, I don't select only one arm at a time, right? I actually select three or four, right? I show three news stories or three ads and things like that. So this is called the multi-slot problem. And the payoff that I'm going to get for a story, right, will depend on what are the other stories I'm showing along with it, right? Or the payoff I'm going to get for an ad depends on what are the other ads I'm showing along with it, right? So the payoffs now start getting becoming dependent on each other, so it becomes more and more complex. So people look at different kinds of complexities, and then there could be budget restrictions. You know, I have say 15 minutes left on my talk, right? So what are the slides that I'm going to show? What are the arms that I can pull now, right? So this is a kind of a budget restriction. So given that I have only X number of pulls, right? So I have to make a different kind of trade-off between exploration and exploitation. Right? So likewise, you could also think of a non-stationary setting. So people typically talk of these as adversarial bandits, right, where the reward distributions keep changing over time, right? So how do you track these efficiently, right? And so those kinds of questions that people ask, right? And then of course the extension to the full reinforcement learning problem, which I'll talk about next, the full reinforcement learning problem. But there are different dimensions in which people are looking at these. And if people are interested in knowing more about bandits, there are a few very good tutorials that are out there. And I presume that the slides will be available online somewhere, right? So off the workshop page, so you can pull these references later, right? So let's now talk very briefly about the full reinforcement learning.
So Ravi, if I may just jump in,
sure.
Just to the talks and the slides, wherever possible, will be available from the CCBR workshop page. Yes.
Okay. So when you talk about the full reinforcement learning problem, right? So there is one crucial component in cycle riding that was missing in bandits. So what is the component? So when I actually move in the cycle, right? When I push down with the pedal or when I throw my weight to one side, these are the actions that I could do, right? It causes a change in the system, right? In the bandit case, when I pull an arm, really, it really doesn't change any of the distributions or anything, right? So I can just go back and pull another arm, right? It's more like a fixed problem that I'm solving. But in the case of riding the cycle, so whenever I actually make a movement, right? When I apply control to the system, it actually changes the state of the system. So this is what we call the full reinforcement learning problem, where there is a sequential nature to the problem. So the agent is going to sense a state in which the environment is in, right? So is my cycle leaning this way? Like how fast am I moving and so on and so forth? This is a kind of sensory information that I'm going to get. And in response to that, okay, the agent is going to select an action and perform it, right? And when the agent selects, when it performs an action, that's going to cause a change in the state, right? And again, this is going to go in a loop, right? I sense the state, I perform an action, it causes a change in the state. Right, now the goal becomes not only selecting an action that immediately gives me a payoff, right, but also to make sure that it puts me in a good enough state so that in the future payoffs are also higher. Right, so essentially, I have to look at a long-term measure of performance, not a short-term measure of performance. So where is the performance coming from? So for want of a better place of putting it, right, the computational modeling people actually put the payoff as evaluation as coming from the environment as a separate signal that comes from the environment to the agent. But then if you talk to behavioral psychologists or neuroscience folks, I mean, there's not really a separate channel that comes in. You know? So it might be, I mean, something that just comes in through your visual input. There might be a separate processing channel that tells you, okay, this is a payoff versus this is a state signal. You know, I mean, just look at the thing and okay, I see smiling faces around me. Maybe I'm doing a good job of talking. You know, and I can just pay myself some reward. Not that I was seeing smiling faces around me. So just using that as an example. Right? So that's just a mathematical abstraction. They're putting the evaluation there, right? And so I'm, in the interest of time, I'm going to skip through much of this. So I actually planned for skipping through those slides. So the goal here is, in this case, so earlier we were talking about learning optimal actions to perform, right? So, but in the full reinforcement learning problem, the goal is to learn an optimal policy, right? Where a policy is a mapping from states to actions, right? So I'm going to say, if I'm leaning to the right, okay, move your center of gravity to the left so that you can stay balanced on the cycle. Right, so that's the kind of, I'm going to learn this kind of mapping from state signals to actions. Right, so that is my goal in the full reinforcement learning problem. Right? And so an optimal policy is a mapping such that no other such mapping or no other policy has a higher expected reward. Right, so I have these reward expectations, right? So no other policy should have a higher expected reward. So that's essentially the goal of learning in reinforcement learning. Right? So there are many ways in which you can do this learning. And so there are two main classes of learning algorithms. One that try to learn these policies directly by searching through the space of policies. Right? So I have this mapping from states to actions. Okay, could search through this space of these mappings and then try to learn a policy directly. So another class of algorithms which are very popular, which are probably the more popular class of algorithms, try to maintain what is called a value function. So what does a value function do? Value function makes a prediction as to what is the expected reward for performing a specific action in a given state, right? And then following a policy thereafter, right? So I'm going to start here, and right? I'm going to push down with my right leg, okay? And after that, I know how to cycle, let us say. Right? What is the value of pushing down with the right leg? So what is the payoff I'll get for pushing down with the right leg? So if that action is very bad, if I push down very powerfully the right leg, I'm going to fall immediately. So regardless of how well I know to cycle after that, that's going to have a poor value. Right? But then if I know the exact right amount of pressure to put on it, then I'll have a very good policy for cycling thereafter. Right? For therefore, that action will have a high value. So essentially, I'll use this kind of a predictions of the future outcomes as my values. Right? So that's essentially what the optimal value function tells me. Right? So what is the use of this optimal value function? So let us denote the value by QSA. Right? This is a convention from one branch of reinforcement learning. So different branches use different values and notations. So Q star SA is the expected value of starting in state S, right? I'm performing action A, and I'm going to behave optimally thereafter. So I don't know what optimally is, but I'm going to behave optimally thereafter. Right? What is the payoff that I'm going to get? Right? So that is Q star SA. Right? So suppose I know Q star SA, right? I can recover the way of optimally behaving, right? By just being greedy with respect to Q star SA. Do people see that? I mean, we say I can take action A and behave optimally thereafter. Okay, this is the payoff I'm going to get. So what is the best thing to do now? So among all the A that I could pick, right, pick the one that has the highest Q value. Right, that would be the best action for me to do now. So being greedy with respect to that one step look ahead allows me to recover the optimal behavior. Right, so this is how people solve the RL problem. Because your goal is eventually to get pi star, right? Your goal is eventually to get this optimal policy. You can either do this by searching through the class of policies, right? Or you can do it by trying to estimate this value function and then doing this. So the advantage of estimating value function is that it has got much lower variance than trying to search through the space of policies directly. So it sometimes has better convergence behaviors. So there are many algorithms which people use for estimating this value function. The most popular of this is called the Q-learning algorithm. Right? I just wanted to introduce one algorithm to you on this. So it's a fully incremental learning algorithm. Right? Doesn't need any knowledge of the system dynamics. Right? It just uses interaction with the system. Right? And so, suppose I'm in a state S, I take an action A. Right? It's going to cause a transition to a state ST plus 1. Right? So say I'm on the cycle, I push down with my right leg and I tilt to this side, right? So this is the thing. And I'm going to get some payoff along the way, right? So note that even though the system actually has a payoff at every instant, the payoff could be zero, right? So I mean, you need not necessarily get a non-zero payoff at every instant, right? So if you fall down, you might get a minus one. If somebody claps, you might get a plus one and things like that. But then you get some payoff at every instant. So the one-step Q-learning algorithm updates your estimates of the Q function as follows, right? It takes your current estimate, right? And looks at the prediction that you would know the prediction that you would make if you know the Q function at ST plus 1. Right? If I know the Q function at ST plus 1, I know what is the best way to behave starting from ST plus 1, right? And RT plus 1 is the reward that I got for performing AT. So this is the current knowledge. If I know one step in the future, so what will I know? I'll know what is the reward that I'm going to get, and I'll know what is the best way of behaving from the one step in the future. So I know the prediction I'll make at time t plus 1 is essentially this. Right? And the prediction I make at time t is my Q function already. Right? So I essentially take the difference, look at the error in the prediction I make, right? And then I use that for changing the value of the prediction I make. Is it clear? So this is essentially what we call the temporal difference error, right? So this is the prediction I make at time t, because I don't know what is going to happen when I perform at, right? So that's the prediction I'll make at time t, right? And this is the prediction I can make at time t plus 1 about what will happen at time t. Basically, this is like looking back in time and saying, hey, now that I have taken that action, I know that this is the payoff that I'm going to get. So I have a better prediction at time t plus 1, right? So this is called the temporal difference. Okay. Makes sense to you now? Yeah. Sorry? No, I just update the Q function that is predicting what would have happened in the previous time step. Something very similar. I mean, that's got a, yeah, it's a very strong connection to signal processing kind of ideas, yeah. So in this case, what one thing to note here is this is not a one-shot learning, right? So you have to have some kind of iteration going here. So you go through this once, you go through the trajectory once, and then you can go back and update the predictions, right? So and then you're taking advantage of this only when you come to the state the next time. So there is always, I mean, you expect this to happen over multiple iterations. It's not like you learn to play a game in one shot, right? You have to have repetitions before you can learn to play the game. So likewise. Right. Here are a lot of solution methods. So that the temporal difference based methods are all those that use the value function, right? And then you could have policy search methods, which actually use the gradients of the performance, or even genetic algorithms and different variants on that. And also there's more classic techniques like dynamic programming based approaches, stochastic dynamic programming approaches, which are used to solve the reinforcement learning problem. I'm not going to get into this, but there's a lot of literature in a variety of solution approaches for these. Like value iteration and policy iteration and so on and so forth. The fact that the payoffs you are working off is our stochastic payoffs. So there are problems here. One main problem with reinforcement learning is how do you handle large state spaces. Right, so far I've been talking about maintaining a policy pi and also a value function q and so on and so forth. But if I'm going to maintain this for really, really large state spaces, right, say like backgammon, which got many, many board positions, or even cycling, which is essentially a continuous control problem, right? So having a tabular representation of this becomes infeasible, right? So you have to look at some way of having a parameterized representation. You need a more compact representation. You need a functional form for representing these value functions. Or the policies, right? So apart from that, there's another more subtle issue, is the data sparsity issue. It's not just the representation issue, but let us suppose that I have infinite storage capacity, right? And I'm able to represent each possible state, the value for each possible state and the policy for each possible state, right? If I want to learn something about a particular state, then I have to visit the state multiple times, right? And if I have a very, very large number of states, visiting them multiple times is not going to work out. Yeah.
So actually, you
But the prediction you are making is not just of the immediate reward, right? It's of the future. The future I'm going to behave according to pi, what is happening, right? So that is the reason you're correcting the immediate reward by adding your future prediction. So just the immediate reward alone is not enough. Because if I'm predicting only the immediate reward, that's fine. But in the full reinforcement learning problem, I want to know till the end, right? I just don't want to not fall in the next time step. And I want to stay on the cycle till I reach my home, right? So you need to look at the future prediction as well. Right?
So how do you initialize the value of the value function in the first iteration?
Well, it depends on the kind of algorithm that you're using, right? So if you're using stochastic dynamic programming kind of approaches, you can initialize to anything you want, and we have convergence results that will eventually converge to the right value function, right? But then that holds for Q-learning as well. I mean, you can initialize it to anything in Q-learning, right? If you're very, very far away from the true value, it'll take you a long time to converge, but eventually you will converge, right? Having said that, the rule of thumb is, as with neural networks, don't go overboard, initialize it to some small value around zero. Okay. So that will probably get you better convergence across the board. But if you know something about the problem, then try to initialize the value function to something close to what you think it will be. Right. So data sparsity issue is that I really cannot generate as much experience as I want, right? So with all the possible states. So I need some way of generalizing across the inputs. Right. This goes back to the regression problem that Misha was talking about in the morning, right? So we need to have some mechanism by which we can do regression on the value function. Okay, so that's essentially what we look at. And so one of the more recent popular methods, and Ruslan also mentioned about the renewed interest in deep reinforcement learning, right, is to use a deep network for doing that regression that we are talking about, right? So use a deep network for representing the Q function, right, and then use that for then controlling all kinds of things. So this actually goes back to 92. The backgammon player that Jerry Tesoro built, I told you about the world's best backgammon player and all that, actually used a neural network, right? Unfortunately, the marketing hadn't begun then, so it wasn't called deep, it's actually, by today's terminology, he used a deep network. He actually managed to solve this problem. And the more recent thing, right, that kind of make, you know, one of the reasons that the attendance at NIPS doubled from last year is this amazing thing that Google DeepMind guys came up with in playing Atari games. So they're playing arcade games, and people, I don't know, some of you might remember some of these games, right? People here look young enough to have not seen these games, but so these are Atari games. And so these guys actually built a reinforcement learning agent that learned to play these Atari games from scratch, right? So the inputs were actually raw pixels from the screen, right? And the outputs were joystick controls, right? So it's actually the joystick movements, the joystick controls. And they used a deep network. And well, people have done different kinds of things with neural networks, even the helicopter case, right? I mean, that's a very complex thing, or Jerry Tesoro's backgammon. The problem with all of these things was they were like one-shot stuff, right? Nobody other than Jerry Tesoro is a backgammon player in the world, right? But we have a decent enough Atari player in our lab right now, right? So that's the major thing about this, was it was reproducible, right? So they actually released the code, they released the network, they gave a lot of information about how they went about doing it, which given Google's track record probably means that they are 5 years ahead of us internally, they did do this. So in some sense it kind of, you know, gives you this interest and revives the interest in reinforcement learning again, that you can do this. And so that's the more important part about this. And it uses Q learning. This is the amazing part about it, right? It's no complex training algorithm. The Q learning update that I put up there is exactly what the Atari game player used. Okay, they had to use a little bit of tweaking to get that to work, but at the algorithm level, there's nothing different. Okay, that's the Q learning algorithm that I put up there. That's all they used to get this to play. So that's kind of what kickstarted, again, the interest in our final slide, right? So, well, the Atari game playing engine actually takes several days to learn to play well, right? So scaling up is an issue, right? Well, perhaps it should. I mean, I don't know. I mean, it's solving a really hard problem. Do you really want to, I mean, you take like several days to learn to play an Atari game well. Do you really want a computer to come and play it in like an hour and then beat you at it? I mean, so maybe just to keep our egos safe, you would like to have it take several days to learn. But then I think we should also understand the biological underpinnings of RL better in order to build more efficient reinforcement learning systems. And more mundane interest, we need to build more practical applications of RL systems. I mean, RL has been around for, I don't know, at least in this form, RL has been around for 30 years. And in some form or the other, it has been around for longer. And we still have to get applications that are industry ready. There are a few, like the ad selection and the news stories that I spoke about, but we still have a ways to go. And so I'll go back and I mean, this happened also in the backgammon case, right? So so Jerry Tesar actually trained it for several weeks, and he came up with this really neat trick of letting two copies of the program play against each other. So the backgammon, so the way he did it was he trained the agent for like 100 games, right? And then he copied it over to the other side, right? And then he had that agent was frozen, and then only one agent continued learning. And then he froze it after another 100 trials and copied it over. He just kept doing this. And it paid millions and millions and millions of games, right? And then what came out was a fantastic backgammon player.
I was actually talking to the guy in Alberta who did the poker
player. Ah, OK.
Very, David. Very strong player.
Michael Bowling. Michael Bowling's group is the one that actually came up with the Atari simulator as well. Yeah. So, but they don't use deep learning. In fact, they are trying to get a paper out which they call shallow reinforcement learning, as a reaction to all the hype on the deep thing. So Michael's group is working on something called shallow RL, and they actually show very good results on the Atari game without using the deep part. Yeah. So if people have questions, you can ask while we watch the green player who is learning. Still not good, I mean, so it will get better. Of course, this is a really old video that came with the Nature paper that's about 2 years old. And right now, these guys have something that plays at a really amazing level.
I think that little video points out something simple, which is these particles are moving in a line. If I were learning to play it as I did a while ago, I would just move the cursor to the point where you can easily predict the line is going to go, and you could easily code that algorithm, right?
Yeah, but this is learning tabula rasa. I mean, we have a lot of experience. This is something which Mrugaka was pointing out, right? So we come wide for doing a whole bunch of other things.
No, but I think that is kind of the difference between the reinforcement learning algorithm and the biological.
No, the thing is, we are not giving the reinforcement learning algorithm the tools to do this. I mean, if I give it linear predictive models, right? If I say that, okay, I can take the input as the last two states and start predicting, I give you widgets to predict the future, right? So if I give you like this Kalman filter fit.
But what I'm trying to suggest is that the Pavlov and Skinner, the reaction to Pavlov and Skinner within biology was that, you know, there's this famous book called Behavior of Animals, and then there was a book written called The Misbehavior of Animals.
Okay.
When, for example, I think they were training pigs to put money in slot machines or something using reinforcement learning, but after a while the pigs rebelled and, you know, broke the machine because it wasn't a natural task for them. So they were wired for doing something else, not putting money in slot machines. So, but for kind of future looking thing, if one is using it in applications to make the reinforcement learning, let's say, commercially useful, one would probably want to build in more priors and want to build in more structure.
Of course, we really need to build in more prior knowledge.
Right.
I think the DeepMind guys were trying to make a point saying that we can get this far with zero prior knowledge, right? But yeah, I agree with you. I mean, we really need to put in a lot more prior knowledge in order to get the systems to do something that's non-trivial. I mean, yeah, playing Atari games in the larger scheme of things is trivial, right? So for it to do something non-trivial, we need to put in a lot more. Yeah, so that's basically, and there are a few more games that happens on this.
So I think we have 5 more minutes for questions if anyone else has any questions. Please.
Oh yeah, I have one more slide, sorry. Yeah, so references on reinforcement learning, please.
Yeah, so what if optimality is not the right success criterion?
Sure.
For example, you're learning to ride a bicycle or your helicopter starts flying upside down.
Yeah.
It's survival, not optimality, that you want at first.
That is completely
and you
true.
Don't have time to try every arm.
Yeah. So there are, I just spoke about the most basic formulation of reinforcement learning. So there are people who are working on like time-bound reinforcement learning. You know, so I have only a certain amount of time that I need to behave. So what is the best you could do? So this is like extending the regret ideas to the full reinforcement learning problem. So I'm not really worried about optimality, but I'm worried about regret. Right? So what happens during learning, right? And there are other people who are actually looking at issues of safety. You know, so I want to do reinforcement learning, but I really don't want to do something that will break me, right? So there are people who are looking at safety issues, right? So that's another line of work that's happening. And there is a whole Bayesian formulation of reinforcement learning, right? Which has a slightly different definition of what optimality would be, right? I mean, there is the whole regularization gets rolled in there. So I'm more interested in looking at feasible policy classes, not necessarily optimal policy classes. So yeah, so there are many, many variants of this which not necessarily look at optimality. But the bulk of the work, unfortunately, so far has been on looking at optimal solutions. But more recently, the last 5 years or so, people are moving away from that.
Are there any other questions? So then we'll thank the speaker.
Thank you.
So one thing I've noticed is kind of different sub-communities use different terminology, and that often separates problems. So there's at least 3 communities here which are dealing with somewhat related problems. There's a machine learning community that's not doing, that's doing things as a batch, so not taking time into account. There's reinforcement learning, and there's also control theory, you know, So I wonder whether you think one could better synchronize these together. Like one specific question I had was, let's say, supposing you wanted to do reinforcement learning of cats versus dogs. I gave you, instead of training a network up or a support vector machine up to classify between cats and non-cats, you could apply reinforcement learning to that problem. And I show you images one at a time, and I reward you if you got the cats right. That is now a reinforcement learning problem, right? It's well. Okay, so make it into so change it slightly until it becomes a. Fine. Let's say you give it not right. So, but I'm wondering if you know, actually this is a question for anybody in the audience, but certainly for both of you, what are the chances of putting these, even if I go to a conference, I sort of see separate talks with separate terminology, what's the scope for convergence here? Are there common themes being explored or problems where some limit is supervised learning, some limit is reinforcement learning, but there is one problem that goes to both limits?
So at least in the reinforcement learning community, right? So there is increasingly interest in looking at hybrid methods, right? So for example, the soccer team that I spoke about, right? They don't use pure reinforcement learning. They use what they call layered learning, where different components of the problems are solved using different things. I mean, they not only limit themselves to learning. I mean, there were some planning algorithms that were running in there, and there were purely logic-based solutions as well. So, but they managed to integrate everything into a single solution. So parts of it were solved using supervised learning, parts of it using reinforcement learning, and parts of it using logic. And then there is more work that's being done on trying to integrate human supervision with the traditional reinforcement learning as well. Right. So where instead of actually somebody telling me if I got it right or wrong, so maybe on like 5% of the images, you'll tell me what it is really. Right. And then on, say, 80% of the images, you will tell me whether I'm right or wrong. So how would I integrate these kinds of feedback and learning into it? So at the end of the day, right, so I am learning this control policy, right, and the control policy could be learned using whatever signals that I'm getting. It could be reinforcement signals, it could be supervised signals. So people are moving towards, like I was saying, right, solve complex problems, you really need to move towards these kinds of solutions and setups.
Do you feel kind of the linguistic or terminology differences to be a barrier, or I mean, is it like obscuring things? Is there a way of maybe making things more transparent?
Working in reinforcement learning, you have to live with it, right? Forget about other areas. In reinforcement learning, you have neuroscientists, you have behavioral psychologists, you have AI folks, and you have OR people, everybody doing reinforcement learning and everybody having different terminologies. So I think you just have to, at some point, understand that and work with it, right? So yeah, there might be a little bit of an initial hiccup in trying to understand the terminologies across different disciplines, but I think people should get over it. I don't see it as a significant barrier, at least in my experience.
No, I don't mean reinforcement learning. I mean more putting it into the broader machine learning context or in exploring the space between supervised learning and reinforcement learning or between reinforcement learning and control theory. You know, there is maybe a larger field which has these as subfields in a sense. So part of my question is, are there models or questions where in some limit you recover reinforcement learning, some limit you recover supervised learning, in another limit you recover, you know, kind of an optimal control problem. Mm-hmm. And then since these are, in some sense, solved limits of the problem, maybe there's a, you know, meta problem that could be posed.
At least in the case of optimal control and reinforcement learning, I think that's well understood in some sense, right? So, I'm not sure if there is a single larger question for supervised versus, I mean, not the entire gamut of supervised learning. Maybe there is specific sub-instances of supervised learning which could be viewed as reinforcement learning at the limit. But I'm not sure about the entire gamut of supervised learning. So what do you think, Misha?
Well, I guess you can say that reinforcement learning is more general, right? You have this extra information. Some sort of overarching problem which could be usefully, you know, used to think about reinforcement learning and supervised learning? I don't know. So I guess there is some tradition which is a little different. Also the venues are slightly different. There's significant overlap, but there's also difference.
I guess one of the motivations for my asking the question was that, of course, we make these different disciplinary boundaries, the nervous system doesn't. So if the same architecture is solving different problems, then you know one way to make progress in connecting neuroscience to different engineering theories would be to maybe take the nervous system as, you know, so if one, we are not doing purely reinforcement learning, we're not doing purely supervised learning. I'm kind of brainstorming, but I'm throwing this out as a possibility that taking the biological motivation might allow bringing these theoretical frameworks together, perhaps.
Mm-hmm. So, I mean, in some sense, the substrate on which you're implementing the learning, right, can actually be the same. In fact, if you look at what the DQN did, the DeepQ network that played the Atari games, it just took a convolutional network as the underlying representation, right? So you could train a convolutional network using reinforcement learning. You could do it using unsupervised learning. People are doing that for feature learning now, right? And also you could train it using normal supervised signal. And it would be interesting to see what would happen if you actually start training a single network with alternating alternating error signals and things like this. So as far as the implementation issues are concerned, I think there is a single substrate on which many of these algorithms could be implemented, right? So I was thinking more at the level of an abstract learning problem. Is that a single learning problem that they are solving? And that's what I was a little hesitant, because I was not 100% sure. But as far as sharing a substrate on which these things can be implemented, I think that's pretty much there already.
I was actually curious about that. Can you just train it as a supervised learning problem? So can you train the Atari game, the network, using just as a purely supervised problem? Or is there some difficulty with that?
People haven't tried it. I would suspect that you could do it, but you'd need a lot of training data. So I'm getting, I mean, labeling that much data is going to be a pain. You know, I mean, I have to sit and actually go through each frame and then say, okay, this is the right thing you have to do on the frame.
It says in time series modeling, does it lead to the bang-bang kind of control? It gives you a reward.
Yeah, there are some, for example, people have looked at inverted pendulum controllers, uh-huh. Inverted pendulum controls, right? And you can train it to produce bang-bang control using reinforcement learning. Mm-hmm. But then you have to limit the controls available to it as bang bang. So if you give it fine grained control, it actually learns to optimize the cost in the controller. But if you just say only bang bang is available, plus n and minus n is available, it still learns to control. But yeah, it's funny watching it, but it does learn to control.
I have a question that's kind of a dual to what Partha was asking. I see that brain research, the field in ML that's involved is mostly vision, probably a bottleneck because of the imaging techniques. Do you expect other sorts of inputs coming from some advances in imaging techniques in the future, in a few years or something like this?
Well, I mean, you know, from my perspective, I've sort of voted with my feet. I really see that uncovering the circuits might, so it's funny because you're saying the same, we are coming back to the same multiple times. Anand said that, you know, several people said that we've been constrained by the hardware architecture. You just mentioned that, well, maybe the same architecture could be trained using different algorithms. And what I'm saying is, well, if I tell you what the circuit architecture of the brain is, then that might in fact tell you what algorithms you can implement on it. So sort of my kind of voting with the feet to some extent has been to uncovering the circuits, you know, looking at the hardware rather than, I think we have looked a lot at the software and thought about the software and thought about the behavior, looked at the behavior. Perhaps even somewhat of an alternative approach is to start from the hardware side completely. And if you look at the retina, if you look at the visual system, at the retina, certainly people are, through the reconstruction of the EM circuitry, EM reconstructions of the circuitry, one can infer what algorithms are being implemented. But I'd kind of put the question back to Mriganka because he may have things to say about this as well.
Maybe another way in which neuroscience could contribute is
So one kind of thing that Misha and I have explored a little bit is to formalize, maybe perhaps axiomatically, some rules that say algorithms that satisfy these rules are neuromorphic. Because I think that one of the problems in the field is people haven't really defined what it is, what does it mean to conform to neuroscience. So the rules of the game have to be better defined. And one way to do that might, and people are taking it for granted that that's been defined. But it could be that one might want to formalize those things, and then you will see that certain learning rules are not allowed, perhaps, or certain kind of circuit architectures are not allowed. And these may be fairly loose bounds, but that is one way neuroscience could, you know, feed back into machine learning in a pretty concrete way. I think that in the signal processing in the periphery, it may be much more direct. One might be able to do biomimetics. Because, and I don't want to harp on the theme of reconstructing the circuitry, but as we are reconstructing the peripheral circuitry, they match up surprisingly well with signal processing algorithms, which electrical engineers would instantly recognize. It's quite surprising. So just like the camera lie example I was giving that matches a camera, but at the circuit level, now one is starting to see the homologies between signal processing as you would do in EE, and as it is being done in the brain. Learning maybe a little bit further. I mean, we haven't yet reconstructed circuits that will quite get us there, but.
One thing I would say, which I personally am very keen to explore with is, can we take certain pre-existing architectures and see what are the good ones, such as, and of course, you know, don't treat every element as identical. Break up your elements into at least two cell types, excitatory and inhibitory, and bar them up in interesting ways, maybe even fanciful ways, and see if that gets you somewhere, maybe in the world of signal processing, maybe in the world of learning. And some such ideas, you know, I don't know whether engineers are up for exploring it, but I think it can be quite powerful. That to dynamic routing of circuits. A single neuron is part of many circuits, but at any point in time, it is part of one circuit and then another and then another, and there are you know, control systems that allow this neuron to do this at one time and that at another time. And to my mind, that together with the number of neurons and the richness of each neuron, the connectivity of each neuron, that's anatomical, the dynamic physiological routing of circuits together allows for tremendous amount of permutations and combinations possible in the brain. And if one can capture some of this in a clever method, I think that would be very powerful. Together with some of the ideas that the brain, some of the facts that the brain uses, such as dividends, such as attention, such as bottom-up and top-down integration at the level of single neuron.
Be very interesting to have some sort of formal description, maybe very basic, of what the things can do. And then, you know, that's the kind of question computer scientists have been looking for circuits. You know, what kind of circuit can implement what, right? With binary, for example, this is of course not a binary circuit, but you can ask the same question, what algorithms can be implemented, what properties of these algorithms, and so on. I think if some formal description of that would be sort of available, that could really stimulate a lot of work on that.
So maybe we can stop that discussion here and